Boom. And we begin. The podcast is live. We are on Twitch. We are on YouTube. We are everywhere. Dave Molyneux.
Oh,
how's it going?
Eric Antoni. How be thou?
I'm fantastic. It's always fun to get together on a Wednesday afternoon. Now we're doing it live so people can see it while it happens. And it's always nice to have these podcasts just to have them in the archives, looking back at every couple of months, every couple of years, you can listen back to some of our fun conversations, and now we get to share them with more people. Yeah,
we do.
Yeah,
like an infection. Basically, I must admit, I did have a listen back to the last one of these top tens that we did recently, because I genuinely couldn't remember what we listed.
So, thank you for doing that. I appreciate it, because I was going to do the same thing, and then you're like, so I just listened to it, and I'm like, and? I'm like, thanks, I don't got to listen to myself.
I'm not organized in the rest of my life, so this is the one place.
Right? You got to know if you've spent that money already or not, because you need to find a way to spend it somewhere else, which is what these episodes are for, right?
Exactly.
What do we want to spend our money on in the future that we have already?
And if there's one thing people seem to want to spend their money on at the moment, it's Marvel Omnibus editions, basically. So they are for those who don't know, they're the super chunky, often like 50, 60 issue collections from Marvel. So nice, big, thick books that collect complete runs or complete storylines, crossovers, all in one book, or sometimes a run of Omnis. So yeah, they're very, very popular. And they're a good way to collect an old series, like the Peter David one. Ah, Peter David again. but they did the entire 10-year run in 4 books, whereas for trades, that takes, you know, the paperback version takes a lot longer.
Yeah. It's when do you think the omnibus sort of craze started? Because it still is a boutique product.
Yeah.
For collectors, right? Like, you really got to be loving the history and the full scope of a story to want to buy an omnibus. Like, it's an investment, right? Yeah,
unless you're really lucky, you can get them cheap.
Pardon?
Unless you're really lucky, you know how to get them cheap.
Yeah, of course. Which, I mean, that's where we're all trying to get to that.
This is true.
But it's also, in a way, I find the most economical way to read a collection.
Yeah.
In a format that you get all the content in regards to that story if it's a well-produced book.
Yeah.
And it's in a little bit of a deluxe format, really nicely put together, as it should be. Mm-hmm. And I think if you were to go back and buy all of those issues,
if you bought the issues, you'd be broke. Like, in comparison, it's a lot cheaper. Even if you buy the trades, trade paperbacks of that run, it costs more.
Yes.
Especially with new comics. When they release new comics, I think nowadays they're like 4 or 5 quid over here. I don't know what they are in Canadian monies. Rupees.
Dollars.
That we just might be dollars. Zelda. I can't remember. As an example, I do have one to hand. This is a fairly recent one. This is the Wolverine.
Yeah, we can do that now. It just dawns on us.
It's good, isn't it? We're on screens.
Yeah.
It's just Wolverine Volume 3 Omnibus. So there's like... I can't actually see, though, because I'm old and blind. But it's basically like this Wolverine. I'm not going to read everything that's in it. 31 to 59, plus a whole load of one-shots, annuals, Marvel Comics present. So it's all the Wolverine stuff collected. And it is... It seems like an expensive purchase. It's actually cheaper to get them that way.
Yeah, I just had delivered to me the Daredevil by Frank Miller. I had them in the original sort of trade format, because I hadn't read it before. So I'm going to, you know, buy one at a time and see if I still like this Daredevil run. But it's one of my favorite collections, right? Frank Miller, we've talked about it.
We have.
On an incoming episode. Maybe I think the January one. Anyhow.
Yes.
All of those issues within this book, if you were to go out and try to find them, good luck. Good luck trying to find it. I mean, you could do it digitally. That is, of course, a way to get around. But it's not the same experience.
It's not just the same smell.
Yes. You're right. Yeah. You're right. It comes down. You know what? It's funny you should mention that before we get into our top 10 picks. Yeah, no, it's I bought forgot what it was. I bought a couple of collections from BMV. Shout out to BMV. It's our store in Toronto that everybody loves going to. And it was a Batman Catwoman from Tom King. My wife's a big Batman fan. And she cracked open the book, started flipping through the pages, and I caught her bringing it up to her face and smelling the book.
She's hooked.
That's it. It's such a weird thing to talk about. Like, for me, my wife's smelling books. But for book collectors, right?
Not in a sex way.
Not in a sex way, but people who love the experience of reading, even just the paperback, the glue, the ink, the just everything combined, it gives off an aroma that connects with the brain, right?
Yeah, it's part of the experience, isn't it? It's like it is, it becomes this very familiar thing. And like, I mean, on top of that as well, like the way they're produced, they're really nice, heavy stock paper. Sorry, I'm just checking my mic. It's right. The heavy stock paper. That really threw me.
No, that's okay.
But yeah, it has got the whole smell, the whole experience, and also they're oversized, so they're bigger than your standard comic size.
Mm-hmm.
So all in all, it's just a nicer experience. Some people say, like, aren't they too heavy? Aren't they too heavy, though?
I used to say that. Aren't they uncomfortable
to read? Like,
it's actually comforting after a while.
Yeah.
It's like a weighted blanket.
Yeah, basically it is. So I have a little cushion, and I've got my reading chair. Oh, what an old man. I've got my pipe. I've got a packet of Werther's and I've weed myself. And then I feel like that's the perfect situation.
It is. It really is. It's one of, like, I bring up all the time when we had to be at home and there wasn't much to do outside in the last couple of years. That was what I got around to doing a lot more of. Like, the omnibus reading experience is what, I don't know, maybe that was something that, I think it was before that, but I feel during the last 2 years, the one thing that started to really be produced a lot were omnibus.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's just me.
But it's increased dramatically. I think they do need to kind of tone it back a bit, Marvel. They've kind of gone overboard, but saying that, we're actually going to talk about 10 that we actually really won.
I'll be honest, making this list, all the ones that we mentioned on the last episode, a few of them have come out. So it was on the Cave of Solitude podcast. Me and you did a top 10 most wanted Marvel omnibus, and yes. I think the Christopher Priest Black Panther has been released.
Yes.
And there was a couple other. Oh, they've announced the Janice Vell.
They have announced Janice Vell one. There was Spider-Man, Superior Spider-Man.
Yes, that's
They were the three that we kind of nailed.
Yeah, it's because of us.
It's totally because of us. I was cupping David Gabriel the other day, and I said, David, just hum a little more if you can. What? Is that the wrong
thing? Yeah, that's not. It's out. Oh boy, but a couple of the things that I wanted to put on my list this time around still haven't been, like, there's no indication. So one is going to make the list still. One will be a reserve, just honorable mention.
Okay.
Was it hard for you to pick some?
No.
You're such a nerd. I found it hard. I think pretty much everything that I'd like to read, like, they've, anything I could think of, like, oh, they already made that. Well, they've already done that. It's Marvel's printed a lot of.
They have, but there will be something. I guarantee you, the five that I pick, if they don't duplicate, you'll at least one of them. You'll go, oh, I hadn't thought of that. Then
I'm excited.
Vice versa.
I'm excited to hear what you've got there. Before we begin, if I may, can we shout out our show producer?
Yes, we can.
Because we shouted her out when we thought we were live.
Yeah,
and we. And she deserves a proper shout out to your wife.
Yes, well, my wife, Mish, thank you very much for producing the show and working on all the website and basically making this whole thing run. She is the unsung third omnivore.
Exactly. She deserves a lot of credit, so thank you. And if there's anything you need to tell us during the show, please feel free.
Well, Reed Reeds actually says epic collections all the way for me, so if you could just leave the live broadcast read that read reads.
I love the Epic Collections too. I'm a big fan of those. I just don't collect all of them.
No.
No. What was your hang up about them again?
The spine. Don't even go there.
Okay. All right. You're right. Sorry. I'm sorry.
That's all right. Okay. Should we do it? Should we get in?
Let's do it. You go first, Dave.
Oh god, okay. So my first pick is okay, they've done a couple of these. They've done a couple of villain-centric ones. One was Doctor Doom. Which like collects a lot of the key stories of Doctor Doom over the years. They've done a Loki one, which actually, they've done a couple of Loki omnibus collections. One was an actual series, so it was Journey into Mystery, but another one was key appearances again over the years. Was there anyone else? I don't know if any others have been announced, but I've never bought any of those. I don't tend to like those collections, but I really, really want a Kang omnibus. I love Kang. I love him. Like any story, I don't care. The stories don't make sense half the time. I don't care. I love Kang. It's just got a ridiculous name. He's got thigh high boots. He's a kinky bugger. He's got a mask on that's got like as if he's crying.
Are you excited for the Ant-Man movie?
No. Are you?
Not really.
No.
I'd like to be pleasantly surprised, but I'm not counting down. I used to count down to Marvel movies, like just a couple, you know. But now I'm sort of, I don't know. But Kang is here. Kang has arrived.
Yeah.
They're going all in.
It would be, I think the film version is like a cover version, though, isn't it? It's like the popcorn version of something else. We'll see. They might do it justice. Who knows? I mean, I'll try and be open-minded. I'm going to hate it. Kang himself, I love him. I first saw him in Secret Wars back in the day when we first met. And he was only in it really briefly because I bought a few issues in and he just gets killed straight away. But you could buy the figure. And I don't know what it was about the figure, just the whole thing with his name and the time travel thing. And we were talking about time travel a bit last week, so, you know, it's a bit of an obsession. But he's just got some really weird stories. And it kind of opens.
I was actually thinking about Kang. Like I said, what's something that would be fun for us to talk about that may be able to tie into pop culture? And I said we should read Kang's story and just talk about it, review it, do our book about the month club of a Kang story.
I would love to.
We should. We should. Yeah. You pick one since he's one of your favorite characters. What do you think is like a key or a favorite of yours?
One I haven't read in a long, long time is the Avengers Roger Stern one, 267 to 269. God, nerd, off the top of my head. I'm actually looking at our page. So we have recently done a Kang reading order on the omniversecomics.guide website. And it puts them all into chronological order, bearing in mind the guy travels through time, so it's not necessarily in release order. But that one is the first one that springs to mind. I know you read it fairly recently, but
not too long ago, but
I haven't read it in a long time.
We could do that one. I don't mind.
We'll do the book that it's in. So we can What's read that? A few extra. I think it's in one called Time and Time Again. Avengers Kang, Time and Time Again. So we could do that whole book.
I have it in the Epic Collection.
Oh, I've got to read all that much.
I don't know if it's those other books are in
print.
I don't have the Kang Time and Time Again. I know the trade you're talking about, though.
Oh, I thought you did.
No, okay. I have.
We'll figure that out.
Yes, but we should. Something Kang related.
Yeah. So, I mean, it'd be good to include that, though. Obviously, the early stories, the original appearances, the Rama Tut appearance, which, of course, is the first appearance of Kang, but he's not called Kang. Appearances of him as the Scarlet Centurion. I suppose the Celestial Madonna saga, even though it's a bit weird.
I want that this year.
Oh.
I don't care.
I don't like. there are a couple of others, but I think up to like, if they did up to Avengers Forever and Kang Dynasty, perfect. Perfect collection. They could always do a second volume if they wanted to. I'd probably get that as well.
Yeah, those are some good stories. Really, really good stuff. Kang Dynasty is something, it's so weird.
Yeah, it's weird.
It's so epic. That's a good one. And, what was the other one you mentioned? Oh, Avengers Forever. Forget about it. Forget about it. That I was hoping you'd want to review that one because I haven't.
Oh, we could
that.
Do that. We'll figure it out. Maybe we do Avengers Forever or Kang Dynasty. Either one.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah. Kang Dynasty. All right. So a Kang centric omnibus, and you basically mapped it out up until Avengers Forever or Kang Dynasty.
Well, I mean, the reading order covers everything from first appearance to now, but for the book, I would go beginning to Kang Dynasty.
Got it.
Space allowing. Space and time allowing.
Right. Okay. My first pick. I got a lot here that aren't necessarily in order, just in case we have doubles, but I'm going to have to stick with Avengers Roger Stern. I have to. Yeah, that was my number one on the last list, I think. It just doesn't make sense.
No, it's funny because it's one of those ones that I thought after last time, it was inevitable.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know if they're waiting for an Avengers movie that is going to have elements that will make people be like, well, you know, this story is from this omnibus or this collection. Like, it's worth... I don't know what they're waiting for. There's got to be a reason because in most comic book nerd circles, I'll say, it's kind of one of those accepted things that the Roger Stern era of the Avengers is a very, very strong, if not the best, for a long-term period of time. John Buscema on the art with Tom Palmer. Just the artwork itself is...
With the exception of the Al Milgrom issues with everyone falling over. But I mean, it's a shame that it starts with those issues because, like, oh, they're just painful to look at. And it's not a fair judge of the rest of the run because he doesn't stay on. And actually, you can kind of get accustomed enough to his artwork. It's fine. And the stories are good.
Yeah. That's the thing. He really makes a dense, nicely, like you care about the Avengers during that time and their relationships the same way you were for the X-Men.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And when you get that simpatico between the artist and the writer and the world just starts to look, and it was kind of timeless. Like you could read those issues now and they're oops.
Did you fall over?
No, that was my dog. Oh. My dog was walking over to me and she just lost her footing.
Oh.
Is okay.
Okay.
I just feel that one is one, like, they've got an Avengers omnibus for everything else. It seems like they've got all of the Stan Lee stuff, they got the Roy Thomas stuff collected.
Mm-hmm.
This one is just a, I don't know, I just feel it's a blind spot.
It is a massive blind spot. It's a hefty run though, isn't it?
That it might
be a two booker.
Yeah.
I'm having to double check because I couldn't remember off the top of my head, but there's loads of little filler issues he does, but it's from officially 227 to 228, 288 essentially, with a couple of annuals. But there's loads of other stuff as well they could include that he's worked on, like Wonder Man and Beast miniseries. He also contributed to Avengers Forever, so double up there. There's tons of stuff that would actually probably pad it out to at least two volumes.
For sure.
And sell.
It would definitely sell because it's one of those, I think, series where people will buy the volume one just to make sure that the volume two stuff is completed because it's under siege.
Yeah.
And, you know, the final issues in Olympus and the Kang, the time and again.
Yes. The Vision stories as well, though, in that first one. Like
Absolute Vision.
Absolute Vision. Just the weird secret. Oh, and the introduction Legacy of West Coast Avengers.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and you referenced that story, the is it Gamora story? Nebula.
The War to End All Skrulls.
Yes,
because those issues as well, they tie really closely with the Fantastic Four Burn run. So if you read them together, it actually becomes a different experience.
And it's looking like as the multimedia of Marvel has expanded to the way that it has, you see that the seeds for these stories to germinate, where you finally get to Jim Starlin taking over Silver Surfer,
mm-hmm.
very nerdy territory, but the seeds are planted with this Roger Stern run in a lot of ways.
Yeah, there's definitely some parts that cross back over.
Yeah.
Like Destruction of Xandar and Introduction of Nebula and all these other bits. There's a lot of stuff. It all interlinks. And that was probably the time when it interlinked best.
Yes.
In the 80s. It wasn't overwhelming, but if you read it together, you were rewarded.
Yes, agreed. So that's my pick. I'm going with that one because I need to give it up.
That's the only repeat you're allowed, isn't it?
That's the only repeater. I promise.
It's a worthy repeat. I was talking to shout out to Omega Bread, who follows us on Instagram, and he actually said, literally earlier today I was chatting to him and he mentioned that one. It's the first one that came to mind. That there are people begging for this, that run to be collected.
Yeah, they're doing every other Avengers whatever.
Yeah.
But this one is the keys. Like
it
this
feeds so everything.
Really does.
Yeah, it needs to happen. Okay. Are you happy for me to go with a number two?
Go ahead.
So my choice, my second choice for tonight is Hulk by Bruce Jones. It's a bit of an odd run. Like it had a lot of praise when it came out. And then I think some people were a bit weird about it by the end, but I loved it. So a lot of people talk about Immortal Hulk like it's the first time Hulk was a true horror series.
Right.
It's not. Bruce Jones's run is when it was first like a true horror series. There were elements in other bits over the years. Like initially, of course, he was more like a monster comic than a superhero comic. Back in the Stan Lee, Steve Ditko, Jack Kirby era. A lot of people forget Steve Ditko did an issue of Hulk as well.
Mm-hmm.
Weird issue, but yeah, he did. Yeah.
That was Stan Lee tried to make an escape route for the characters he was making. He didn't call anything superhero yet, right? It was a lot. No, it's a monster.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, Marvel, before it kind of became Marvel, was still monster comics, you know? So the first thing that the Fantastic Four did was they fought giant monster.
Right.
Because most of their stuff was monster comics, westerns, romance stuff, and weird comedy animals.
Yeah.
Superheroes were kind of dead in the water until DC started bringing back and modernizing Flash, Green Lantern, and everybody started the Silver Age. But yeah, I mean, initially the Fantastic Four didn't even have costumes. So it wasn't, I mean, like who then came next? Iron Man didn't look particularly superhero-y. There was Thor, who's a god. He's not, you know, it wasn't superhero.
Just maybe Spider-Man would have been the most, the quickest to get accepted with that sort of term.
Probably because, him, maybe even Ant-Man.
Yeah. Because it's
that who came first. Into
a homemade costume, going out, fighting a bad guy, saving the city.
Yeah. I think even now, like if you look at some characters like Daredevil, you can kind of go, the superhero bit of Daredevil is kind of a background thing. It's like a noir crime thing where the guy happens to wear pajamas and punch people in the face. But Spider-Man will always be a superhero comic. That is the superhero genre very much. Like with Superman, it's the same. There aren't that many costume characters that I see as just playing superheroes. But yeah, I mean, with this Hulk run with Bruce Jones, part of it harked back to the old TV series. You know, it was Bruce was kind of on the run. He was using false names, wandering around the place, just being a bit sad. He was wanted in connection with a kid being killed. He was being accused of this, so like these people were trying to track him down, and then as it goes on you start to realize that the organization tracking him down are maybe not as government connected as you thought they were, and it becomes a bigger mystery. I think initially the art is by Stuart Immonen, who's just always amazing. Eventually Mike Deodato takes over, and he really suits the series. Like he draws very muscular.
How long is the run?
It's do you know what? Because my memory's terrible. I will just confirm. So basically it's Incredible Hulk. So like after the Peter David run, it lasted a few issues and then they cancelled it. And then they gave it a relaunch with John Byrne and Ron Garney. It wasn't good. And then Paul Jenkins took over and it was better. And then this came in. So it was literally of that series, it was issues 34 to 75. And he also wrote a four-issue Hulk Wolverine mini in that time as well, and a Hulk and Thing four-issue mini.
So why does the... I hear people mention it and say, you know, that was actually a really good, underrated, like they... It's one of those, hey, remember that run? But they also say that at the time, it was very good. But why isn't it remembered or celebrated enough where this Al Ewing run, it's made out to be like this... We've never seen comics this good before.
No, I think part of the thing with the Al Ewing run, and I mean, I'm not knocking people for liking it. It's absolutely bare. You know, it's just not for me because it feels less about character and story. I know people think there's a lot of character development in it. It feels just like a bit too shock factor for me. The big event, the big moment, you know, it's, so I didn't even stay with it. Whereas with the Bruce Jones run, it felt a bit more like Banner was a bit more central to it. So it was a bit more interesting with him as a character, because obviously during the Peter David run, it's all about his diverging personalities and eventually merging them. This kind of took it back to exploring who Bruce Banner is and what happens when he's kind of cornered. But I don't know. It was really highly praised, and I don't know why it suddenly just kind of fell off.
Yeah.
But it's good. And it all builds up to a big ending with a big reveal, and it worked. But it just, I think after that then, because it was Marvel Knights title for a bit as well to kind of bring more attention to it. But
right.
It just sort of, I think they brought back Peter David for a bit, and then they went into the whole Planet Hulk thing, and then everyone was just going, Planet Hulk is amazing. Like, yeah, but there was also an amazing run just 5 minutes ago. Go read it. And at that point in time, it was harder to as well, because, you know, collected editions were really just coming together at that point. I think you could buy it as a series of hardcovers as well as the paperback. So they were starting to do that, but I don't know, it just got forgotten over time. And it's a real shame because it's great stuff. Everyone thought Bruce Jones was new, but like he was writing Kazar in the early 80s and stuff. Like he wasn't a new writer. He'd been writing comics for a while, I think for DC as well.
Hmm. Well, yeah, that's a good pick. You were right. There were ones that I said, what more do we need printed? That's a good pick. And it's a good for one volume where you could get an entire creative vision. Well, I like those type of omnibus.
I think they're about to release later in the year anyway, the John Byrne, Joe Casey issues. So they could probably do the Bruce Jones stuff with the Paul Jenkins book, unless they re-release the... Anyway, there are ways they can do it, but I think it'd be a nice, tight Bruce Jones run on its own. That would be fine with me. I'd be happy.
Unfortunately, this is the pessimist, I guess you can say, in me. We're going to have to wait for the Hulk to have a MCU-related thing for them to do this, it
we'll
seems.
We'll see. I mean, the thing is that the John Byrne, Joe Casey one is coming out later this year, and I don't know if it's supposed to tie into anything. I think it's because they've just finished the Peter David run. Maybe it sold really, really well, and they want to just continue producing that stuff. So,
I hope so.
Yeah.
Good pick. I like that.
Thank you.
So this is another one that I think I felt like I mentioned it before. Maybe it was an honorable mention. And I imagine that, I don't know, we talked about the fact that Iron Man doesn't have enough omnibus representation amongst the omnibus on the shelf, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's a couple things, but some obvious ones that make you go like, why hasn't that been collected yet? I'm not sure if people just don't buy the volumes or what, but I think the Matt Fraction Iron Man run is deserving of an omnibus collection.
Yes, absolutely. Joe, it's the first time I liked Iron Man.
I think it's, and what's good about it is that, well, this isn't to say what's good or bad about, but I think one of the positive things about it is that it's a good entry level place for people to read Iron Man, because it starts to really meld the Robert Downey Jr. sort of characterization.
Yeah.
And it's being this is when you start to see the transition happen between, you know, the multimedia and the comics informing one another.
Yeah.
So I think it's really good for a person who wants a good Iron Man story, because that it is, and then as well as a person who's familiar with the Robert Downey Jr. characterization, you'll feel that that's who you're reading.
Yeah. I mean,
don't know if they haven't done it yet.
They what? They haven't collected it? Yeah. Well, even when they started doing it as a deluxe edition.
Yeah.
And then it just stopped. There was no volume two.
I wonder why.
I don't know. Maybe, I don't know. I really don't know. Because like, it's worthy. It was winning awards. I mean, the one problem with it is if you buy it fresh, not knowing much about what's going on at the time.
Yeah.
The first 7-issue arc, they'd have to include The Order, I think, or at least some issues of The Order, which was a 10-issue miniseries that Matt Fraction was writing, because a lot of the elements are introduced in there that then lead into that, the Fraction Invincible Iron Man series. But yeah, so the first 7-issue arc is a good standalone Iron Man thing. He's in charge of S.H.I.E.L.D. at that point in time. But then the story after that, he's on the run because of what happens in Secret Invasion. So they'd have to at least explain what happened there. But it's still a really good story because he's literally on the run. And like each issue, there's his brain. I don't want to spoil too much, but like basically he's in a really bad situation. And he gets to wear different armors from over the years. And he's being chased by different people. So like War Machine goes after him and Namor goes after him. And
gotta reread it. I gotta reread it.
There's a lot that happens in it. And then it sort of settles after Dark Reign and Siege, and then it's like just you can just read that series on its own for the most part, apart from The Fear itself, but let's not even go into that. But for the most part, yeah, you can just read it on its own because they made the right choice. Because like in terms of a cinema going audience, if you want to pick up an Iron Man series, that should be the Iron Man series. So you don't want to make it tie too heavily into 30 other titles. But yeah, I don't know why they haven't collected it.
How many omnibus do you think it would take? Two,
maybe two. Off the top of my head, Two. Well, they could do a really big hefty one, maybe.
I think it would be two. It's 11 trades.
11 trades, it would be two.
It'd have to be, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Six.
Well, I mean, the thing is, I think there was like a Thor Iron Man series, which I think was by Matt Fraction as well. So they probably include stuff like that. There might be the odd little crossover thing. There was like Shattered Heroes. Fear itself, 7.3 or something that came. Which ties in, and there are the annuals and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I feel like this, again, it's in that same category as the Roger Stern Avengers. Like, how come? Like, why?
Yeah, it's weird. It's always been weird. Like, I really don't get it. I don't think they've even done it as epics, unless I'm mistaken.
No, they have. They just hasn't been, which, the Roger Stern run or the Iron Man?
The Invincible Iron Man Fraction.
No. They, like you said, they had, I think initially it had come out in a couple of hardcovers. I just don't know if they've ever completed it in any form.
Just paperback, I think.
Yeah, if they did the Thor omnibus, which I haven't heard anything that was groundbreaking or vital, unless you're a big Thor fan. But
I'm really hazy on that Thor run.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like anything people, you know, bring up to say, you got to read this. But for Iron Man, this is recognized.
Award-winning series, not collected yet. Hello?
Yeah. That is my obvious pick, I think, for this one.
It's a good pick because it makes sense. And it was on my list. Not my direct list, but it was on the list of stuff I was choosing from. And it nearly made it. It nearly made it. Am I shooting?
Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm just going to blurt it. Spider-Man Big Time would probably be a two-volume run. It was released as what was it? Ultimate Collection?
Yeah.
Editions as well at one point that were quite hefty. So it's like, it could be. So it takes place after the Spider-Man Brand New Day stuff, which took place after One More Day. We won't talk about that. But basically, it was when they'd already kind of tried to refresh Spider-Man and lose Mary Jane and Dan Slott basically takes the reins, because it was different writers during Brand New Day, so it was, they consolidated down to one Spider-Man title but three issues a month instead of three Spider-Man titles a month, and then they'd switch out writers. But then with Big Time, they just basically went, Dan Slott's in charge and he's writing it all the time. And it was, you know, whatever people might say about the run now, because he was on it for quite a while and I didn't read the end of it, the post Secret Wars stuff, but it's good. It's really, really They it's literal fun comics. It's great artists. You've got great stories. You've got Spider Island in there, which was the big event with people turning into spiders in New York City, which sounds ridiculous, but it was really good fun. You've got, oh God, what was the other big event? Oh, there was Ends of the Earth as well, which played a big role in things. But it all built up as well to Superior Spider-Man. And all the events that take place in that run are key to Superior Spider-Man. So releasing that first would have made more sense than releasing Superior Spider-Man first, because you need to read Big Time first.
And it's worthwhile.
Yeah.
I know that Dan Slott is one of those sort of polarizing writers. Some people really appreciate his stuff. Other people think he's like, eh. But I'll always give him credit where it's due, because his time on Spider-Man was lengthy. It was like Peter David long with the amount of issues.
It was
a lot of Spider-Man story that he found a way to tell. Mm-hmm. And it's strong. It's a consistently good, even down to the end, like when Peter becomes the multi-billionaire inheritor of what, spoilers, happened from Superior Spider-Man, right?
Yeah.
Peter's not down on his luck necessarily, we'll put it that way. Yeah. Even that stuff was like, it's that typical thing that writers go through, right? Like you're tell this story, wrap it up. Like, we're with you, we're going to support it, we appreciate everything you've done, but we know that there isn't much left now. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if any writer would have been able to pull that off, really.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. He definitely stayed. I mean, I don't know if he stayed on too long. He outstayed his welcome. But I mean, I'd still probably happily read the rest of his run. So if they continued after Superior and they carried on with that, I'd probably be interested in giving that a read as well. But the Big Time stuff, just to confirm it, that's Amazing Spider-Man 648. For those of you who like your single issues and whatnots, to 697. So it's a chunk. It's a big old chunker. And then there's like mini add-ins, like Alpha, Big Time, which, I mean, the Alpha storyline wasn't great. But whatever, it can't all be gold.
But there's so much gold. Yeah.
There is. And like, I had so much fun reading the Spider Island. I love Spider Island. I thought it was fantastic. A lot of
fun. Yeah.
And then, of course, later on after Superior Spider-Man, you get Spider-Verse, which is also fantastic. So like, he's done some great stuff on it. I don't honestly know why people bitch and moan about it so much. But I think people forget how good the early part of his run was.
And to give him a little bit more credit, he kind of rescued what everyone was so upset about. Brand New Day or One More Day was such an atrocity. Like, I know I'm being dramatic, but it was so horribly handled.
It was really bad.
To try to reset or refresh in a character, right? And I don't think Dan Slott told stories. I was like, hey, this is kind of fun. Like, it's kind of cool that we get these stories that we wouldn't have been able to get had he stayed status quo prior to, that's right?
Fair. So,
you know, it was, this sounds horrible, but it was like from the wreckage.
It totally was.
Something emerged that we get the Miles Morales as a multi, I know it's a Brian Michael Bendis character, but with the Spider-Verse and everything kind of the way he juggled all of the plates for the Spider-Man universe, and really, like, out of that you get Spider-Gwen, and then you get all of these different things that come out of the Dan Slott stuff. Like, it was a real nod in respect to the character
and building. He understood the past, but he built a direction, a new direction for it, and that was tough because he was battling, he was fighting uphill for that. So totally. It paid off, and I probably would have if it hadn't been. I think I was considering dropping the title at that point. I was buying singles at that point.
Right.
I probably would have if it hadn't been as good as it was.
Yeah, no, it was solid. And again, ambitious to do a series like Superior Spider-Man.
Yeah.
I remember him telling a story how he had to go around with security because of people like sending death threats. Yeah, he had, Marvel had said, you've been given like death, legitimate death threats. So he would have to go to these signings and stuff with security hired by the company, not like him saying, people want to get me. Yeah, it was weird.
Wow.
It was a really weird time for him. So there you go.
You comic fans are freaks, aren't you? Thanks for listening.
Who's, is it your turn, my turn?
Kid. That was my big time. So it's your number three.
Okay.
I like the way you choose on the fly.
Yeah, I don't have, because I also base it on what you might pick.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
I got some over. I'm like, oh, I got more things to pick now.
Oh, it's nice, though. Okay. We do, I like the way we do it completely different ways.
I'm just all anarchy. You're like, look at him. He's crazy. He's nuts.
He's on the edge.
Speaking, I'm going to stick to the Spider universe.
Okay.
Spider alternate universe, if you will. And I'll send a special shout out to Reed Reeds, because I know he would love this. And that's Spider Girl Omnibus series.
Uh-huh.
From Tom DeFalco. I think it's Pat Olive on the art.
I think it is. I don't know how long he stays. Sal Buscema, I think, is in there as well. Maybe he inks.
He's mixed in there as well. Yeah. And then I think Ron Frenz comes back to it. It's
yeah.
It's in a lot of ways, if you want it to be continuity, you can. That's how fun it is. And it kind of makes sense with the as a legacy character. It's like, oh, that would be nice. Like if this would make you kind of see, like if One More Day didn't happen, you could see that being sort of the outcome of Peter and Mary Jane's family and marriage and child. It's a nice legacy story, and I think it really builds on the Marvel universe, all the little things within it that, you know, Easter eggs and the way of it gives Marvel a legacy, which they don't have the way DC does.
Yeah, that's true.
Right?
It was a funny one as well, because like, so they introduced her in What If 105, I think it was.
Yeah.
But it, when they were talking about it, so I think that was a trial to see if they'd launch it as an ongoing. Which they did, because it was popular enough. For What If, that was just before it was cancelled, so like that series wasn't selling. But it was a really popular issue. And then, so it kind of spun out of the Clone Saga in a lot of ways as well, which, you know, there were some fans that really loved the Clone Saga. Some people wanted to just forget it ever happened. So there was all the stuff that happened with Mary Jane's pregnancy, and this was almost like it was essentially What If it hadn't gone that way.
Right, right.
And there's loads of callbacks to it. So you get Ben Reilly references, you know, the Scarlet Spider stuff. And, you know, you get all the Norman Osborn's son. Was he Harry Osborn's son? Was he Normie?
Normie, yeah. That's the thing. It's everything that you, if you were a longtime Spider-Man fan, you could read this book and feel like, oh, that's where the characters ended up. It really paid homage to the history of the Marvel Universe.
And they said as well in this, because they always go, when things are set in the future, like the Spider-Man 2099 books and stuff like that, it's always like this crazy Blade Runner style.
Yeah.
Everything's really smoky. Corporations rule everything. Oh, we're there. but yeah, it's always this unbelievable future. But yeah, when you think like, okay, it's probably 20 years from now, because Peter's in his, what, mid-40s or something. Maybe towards his 50s. Got a bit gray. I can relate. Yeah. He's got one leg or something. And yeah, it's like the future, things haven't evolved that much. I mean, there's bits of technology that have, but for the most part, we still live in houses. We're not on silver skateboards that fly through the sky. So they didn't make it ridiculously futuristic, but it's set in like 20 years ahead from now. So it still feels like a relatable modern world.
Yes. But
we get to see how things pan out, potentially, or could have, you know, for people.
I have a lot of it still to read. But what I have read of it, I'm like, oh, this is actually a lot better than I expected it to be. I thought it was going to be like nice for its time, you know, kind of had a specific direction. But I was just like, this is just good comics, but it's Tom DeFalco. Like I have that sort of affinity for his style of writing. It's just fun, comfort comics.
Yeah. And, yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Yeah. And I think this would be I think people would buy this because it was one of those series that was always on the brink of cancellation from what I've heard and read.
Yeah.
But there was enough people who consistently bought it that would keep it alive.
Yeah.
because it had sort of, I guess, that cult following. So I think that people would definitely pick this up.
Yeah, it'd be good to give people another chance to give it a shot as well. And it is, like you say, it's total comfort comics. It's the kind of thing you could probably give your kids, because it was the MC, they were called the MC2 books, basically, because they released Spider-Girl and then A-Next, which was the next generation of Avengers. But you don't even need, it's not like it all crossed over all the time either. It's pretty much a standalone, ongoing title, which is really rare for Marvel.
Right. With that reference that you just made, I want to send a shout out to the Comic Shenanigans podcast. Adam Chapman has had a lot of discussion about the
MC2
with Ron Frenz and Tom DeFalco. They get into a lot of really cool details about that universe that they built. So if you're interested in anything that we're talking about, you can get a treasure trove of information.
Nice.
Yeah.
Good call.
Yeah, that's, I think they should make that. It's overdue for these other spider books to be introduced.
And for anyone that I mean, in terms of modern readers as well, just as an aside, she ends up in Spider-Verse, the event we've just discussed. So it all comes around, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Just because it's an alternate universe doesn't mean it didn't happen, because newsflash, none of it happened. It's all fiction.
All right.
Cool. Yeah. To me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going for a big one, and I'm not even 100. I literally thought about this before we came on.
Yeah, I'm excited to hear what this one is, because you sent me a message.
I've got two in a row that was like, oh.
Yeah.
One of them is ridiculous. And I think people will go, seriously, what the f-? But this one, it keeps coming up in conversation even now, and I think there's a lot of affection for this period, but it's an entire period of stuff. So it's difficult to want a new Avengers omnibus, because we kind of focus on stuff that, you know, rather, we're not asking for reprints here. We're asking for the stuff they've never printed, but they never finished New Avengers. There was no volume two. So, but they have done a Secret Invasion.
I got it on my list.
I won't mention it too much, because I'm not technically talking about that.
Okay.
So
go ahead.
There's still space if that's something you want to
do.
Basically, they have done Secret Invasion as an omnibus, but what I want is Dark Reign, whether it's Avengers Dark Reign or however you want to do it. It was the period after Secret Invasion when, I don't want to spoil Secret Invasion, but basically the world's completely changed. The Avengers are on the run. We mentioned Iron Man being on the run. That wouldn't necessarily have to be in it, but there are Dark Reign issues from the Matt Fraction run. It went for quite a while, and there were some people that were really upset. I don't want this thing on the top of my comics where it says Dark Reign. Like, oh, boo hoo.
I remember that thing.
Grab
on the top.
A tissue.
What is this about? Yeah.
It was, oh, dude, I loved it. So basically, Norman Osborn has his own team of Avengers and they're villains. So it's kind of the same premise as Thunderbolts mixed in with Acts of Vengeance. So, of course, in Thunderbolts, massive spoilers for everyone knows it now who's read anything since 1997. The original Thunderbolts team were villains. And then in Acts of Vengeance, there's a gang of bad guys who've been gathered together by one mysterious other to coordinate attacks on different characters. So they switch foes. So it's kind of a mix of those two events, but it feels still quite fresh. So Norman Osborn has his own little gang of people running everything, and they're the Cabal. So they're just key villains. And it's a weird mix, because some of them aren't villains either. This whole heroes villains thing, it's like, it's not that defined, because there's Emma Frost on there. There's Namor on there. You know, but then he's got Doctor Doom, the Hood, Loki, and himself, and another person keeping them in check that you don't find out the identity of until later. That's a bit of a weird reveal. But it's... So on his Avengers as well, Hawkeye is Bullseye and Spider-Man is actually Venom, or that was Matt Gargan at the time.
Right.
He keeps some of them as well that were already on the team, Sentry and Ares, the ones that are probably the easiest to influence. Because if you just promise Ares some violence, he's going to join up. And it was a lot of fun, man. It was just, and Wolverine is Wolverine's son.
Right.
So there were two Wolverines at the time, and there's two, you know, and you think like, this could be very confusing. I didn't feel it was, but putting it all together in one place or a series of books, I think could be That could be fun, because there were a lot of titles. And actually, when you look at some of the stuff that people are really excited for, it's stuff like House of M. The House of M Omnibus, I think, has come out, or it's on its way out.
Yeah.
Personally, I don't recommend it, because the tie-ins are largely terrible, but the main series is good. With this, it wasn't really an ongoing Dark Reign series. It was just that theme throughout all the books where Norman Osborn was controlling things, and he was a problem, and he was trying to take down certain people, and they were, so he, by the end of it, he has a list of people he wants to take out, to then take his plan to the next stage. And then it all culminates in Siege, which was a big crossover event where they invade Asgard.
Right.
That wraps it up. But it was massive. It went on for about a year, almost a year and a half, I think.
That was a good era of comic book publishing, I think, for both companies, where everything was very cohesive. They wanted all the books to complement each other and matter, that you would want to read. And the events that took place during that decade were enormous, epic.
Yeah, that's the
thing. Yeah,
because you had Avengers Disassembled to start. You had House of M. You had World War Hulk. You had Planet Hulk. You had Secret Invasion.
Civil War.
How did I miss Civil War? I love Civil War.
Right.
There's some great stuff. Like, it's, and they're really good, impactful events, and it doesn't necessarily feel like you're being forced to buy something you don't really want to invest in, because it was just so good.
Do you feel that Avengers X-Men is the restart? Like, that's the end of an era?
I think Avengers X-Men kind of tails the Fraction Brubaker era. That really puts an end to that. I mean, for Avengers, it kind of already ended, because when it gets to Siege and they relaunch the books, I don't necessarily recommend reading past there with Avengers. And that was like well into, I think by the time they hit Avengers versus X-Men, that was around about issue 16 to 20-ish of those titles, but it wasn't.
That's the heroic age?
The heroic age, yeah. I mean, I love the Bendis Avengers stuff, but I think they should have opened it up to somebody else at that point.
Interesting. Yeah, good pick. Good era. I know you've mentioned that a few times.
Yeah, I love it.
A sweet spot for you and your collecting and your reading.
Yeah, cool. We mentioned it the other day. We had a nice little chat with Nick from Geekable, and it came up during that as well. So that episode of Geekable is going to come out soon as well. So yeah, all right, Nick. Speak to you later. yeah, I'm looking forward to that coming out as well. We shamelessly plug everyone tonight.
Yeah, you know what? Let's take a brief, I guess you could say, interlude, commercial break, intermission. Let's plug a couple of the social media things that we have going on, that people can know where to follow us and either watch us on the lives, the YouTubes. Dave, you got all this stuff. Do it.
I haven't got it on the screen.
Sorry.
You know, I totally forgot. So basically, we are on too many things, but we're doing it all for you, because we love you so much. Don't make it creepy, Dave. Basically, you can follow us on Tumblr. Tumblr's still a thing. You can follow us on there. We are trying with Hive. Hive seems to be a bit of a tricky one at the minute, but we're doing our best. So jump on. There's a load of creators on Hive as well. Fingers crossed it does better than Instagram is. We are still on Instagram, and doing our best to plug away despite algorithms and curses. You can find us on Pinterest. You can find us on Twitter. We are running this show on YouTube after it's finished recording a couple of days later, so you get to see it here first, and then you get the polished proper album version on YouTube. Also Facebook, there's a Discord as well that we have, and we're on Vero, and we're shameless, utterly, utterly shameless. And of course you can jump on the website, omniversecomics.guide. There's no coms, there's no .uks, there's no .com. What's the Canada one? Is it .ca or something?
Yeah.
Is that's it? Yeah. .ca. Yeah. There's none of that. It's just .guide, omniversecomics.guide.
And then as well, you can follow the podcasts on iTunes, Omniverse Comics Guide podcast, Spotify, wherever you look for podcasts, we're there as well.
If you're struggling to find it, honestly, if you can go on either go on Instagram. If you're not on Instagram, we will make sure our link tree is available. So you can go on the link tree. And if you choose podcast, it actually comes up with all the podcasts that we're on. So you can choose your preferred podcast provider to play the episodes on there.
That's right. Awesome. Whose turn is it now? As we get back to the show.
Well remembered, by the way.
Yes.
I forgot.
I try to remember. Okay. You mentioned The Avengers by Bendis not having been collected. I think I'll just let your reference rest where it is, because I think that's a good enough shout out to it in a way, because the Dark Reign stuff and everything is a good shout to that whole generation of Marvel comics. Let me think of something.
Did I totally ruin one for you?
No, not at all. No, not at all. It was one of those things to have to be able to mention that came to my head, but I haven't read enough of it. A lot of the things I'm listing are things that I haven't even read enough of to be like, this happened. And
that's
blah, blah, blah.
Cool though, because like that you know, the want to read
those. Yeah, I want to read these.
We do that on the incoming stuff, don't we, sometimes as well? Like some of the recommendations we give are just things that we desperately want to try, yeah. And we finally get a chance.
Exactly. So I'm reading this now. Currently, and I think it deserves a run, like an omnibus run. And I think it's Silver Surfer, starting with Englehart and going through to the Jim Starlin.
Oh, you got era. That far.
I would give it a couple, because I feel it all ties in and melds into, you know, what happens to the Silver Surfer and the Marvel Universe and Thanos and all of these things that kind of come together. I'm not sure where Ron Mars takes it. And how essential all of those things are, because it could become like bogged down with where do we end the story? Mm. But I think we get to just before the Infinity Gauntlet, yeah. The Return of Thanos. I think that is a solid run of comics that you could continue the rest of it by getting into the Infinity sagas.
Yeah.
I think that's it'd be a perfect sort of spot on the shelf that could be filled into the, in your cosmic sort of tapestry.
You say that actually, it's a good point, because I think in the, I could be wrong, but in the Infinity Gauntlet Omnibus, I think they did the, I could be wrong, correct me if I'm wrong, because I think you've got the Infinity Gauntlet Omnibus, haven't you?
Yes.
Yeah. So they do the 5-issue Thanos thing, and then they don't include the Dynamo City storyline, which takes place afterwards while Thanos is doing the Thanos quest thing, getting all the gems.
Yes.
Silver Surfer is trapped in a floating city in space.
Okay.
But I don't think it's in there. So yeah, they probably could do that run and include those issues, because it's just like when they double up on stuff and you get an Omni, you go like, why are you chucking these in, man? I've got these in that other one.
Exactly.
I think that makes sense actually. Yeah. It's a good shout.
Yeah. I just, there's certain characters that, you know, people, there is an affinity for. There is a fandom for those particular characters, as niche as they might be. But with the way everything has expanded, and you've got games on your phone and all these different ways to interact with the Marvel Universe, I know people who are so into Marvel because of apps on their phone.
Yeah?
Like, I don't know if it was a Contest of Champions. A buddy of mine that I work with, he shout out to Nick. He was telling me he would know more about characters than I did because of the games that he's playing. It was incredible. He's like, yeah, this guy just, and he's the son of so-and-so and da-da-da, and this is his brother. And like, whoa, you really know your Marvel continuity. I'm like, have you read all of these books? And he's like, no, I play the game. And it with bios, right? It comes with a who's who.
Yeah.
And as people play these games, they start to like characters that become available, that become playable, that, you know. So I think Silver Surfer has that sort of a following.
Yeah, he's also one of those characters as well that hasn't been, because he was in that one film. He had his own animated series for a bit. But
yeah,
apart from his kind of 1987 to whenever they cancelled it, 1997, I think they cancelled it. That was a good run. That's like nearly 150 issues. Then he just kind of had the odd mini series again. So like since like late 90s, he's not had, or he has had an ongoing actually, because he had the Dan Slott stuff. but he's there isn't that kind of constant with him.
No, he comes and goes.
Yeah.
And I feel that he's a character who, like, they've collected everything of Moon Knight that you can think of. And I understand the show's a hit, and I understand he's got a cult following as well.
It's about money.
But, like, I think Silver Surfer is just one of those, I'm not sure what it is. People know who the Silver Surfer is.
He's an odd visual, isn't he? Because he's basically a naked guy on a surfboard in space.
Yeah.
People love it. Whenever I forget to post stuff with Silver Surfer, because it, like, when I used to do more crossover related posts on the old Marvel crossover guide, as it was then, I didn't do many Silver Surfer posts, because apart from the Infinity stuff, went a huge number of Silver Surfer ones. But whenever I did, people go nuts for it. Norrin! Yeah. Like, you know, everyone knows his name. Like, he's not obscure, but he's not, like, he's not technically A-list because of the way they don't put him out there enough.
And the thing is, with his history in Marvel, like, there's a lot of the stories that he had an 18-issue series from Stan Lee. Great creative, like, legendary creative team, didn't continue. And then he was in the Defenders for the majority of the rest of the time, or if you want to read Silver Surfer, that's where you can find them. But
at least in chunks. It was weird chunks even with that. He was kind of in and out.
Yeah. But yeah, such an esoteric character. Like, where is he? What's he doing? What's he all about? And the fun part about reading his stories is he's oftentimes trying to figure it out, because he's not really sure a lot of times. Uh-huh. He just knows he wanted to save Shalabal. Right?
Yeah.
We're very nerdy right now. People are like, what? No one likes Surfer that much.
they do.
Go ahead. your turn.
Okay. I'm not even... That's a good pick, though. The Englehart stuff I would desperately, desperately love to see collected in one book, categorically. So really good shout. It was on my almost picked it list.
Okay.
So my final one for tonight, and this is going to be one of those, you know, like last time I did G.I. Joe as my choice. It seemed a bit left field, but and I know that Marvel don't own the rights anymore, at least not for the moment, because we don't know who owns the rights at this point. So the rights to G.I. Joe went over to IDW. I'm kind of hoping they'll go back to Marvel for long enough to get them to release them in omnibus format, but we'll see. This one, I thought about this earlier, it just suddenly sprang into my head. I think I had one of those things where, like, normally I like the odd obscure character. But don't just pick an obscure character. What would you really like to see collected in an omnibus? And admittedly, it wouldn't be a huge one, but it would be Nth Man, the Ultimate Ninja.
What? I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm not going to talk about this long, because literally no one remembers this. Larry Hama did a series in the late 80s, early 90s called Nth Man, the Ultimate Ninja. It was set outside the Marvel Universe. It was about a ninja who was trying to figure out some of his part. It's however you describe it, it sounds cheesy as hell, but it was very, very tongue-in-cheek. One issue was drawn by Dale Keown. It was like a flashback and a horror issue. So when he was a kid in this orphanage, sorry. His brother, is he his brother? Or is he like, I can't remember if he's actually his brother. He's got superpowers. At one point, he gets influenced by the comics he reads, and he reads Marvel. So he ends up massive and dressed as Galactus. But then that ends up jumping into an issue of Excalibur. So there's also an Excalibur tie-in, Marvel Comics Presents story, just 8 issues, and then the 16-issue series. They cut it short because it wasn't selling great. But it was just so odd. And it was all this time travel stuff in it as well. He ends up kind of fighting the Russians and sort of half teaming up. It's just bizarre. But it was like... a real passion project for Larry Hama, who was the writer of G.I. Joe, which is why I mentioned it. And I really liked it. To the point where a mate of mine was going, what comics do I buy? I'll try some comics. Tell me what to buy. And one of the first ones I mentioned was Nth Man, just because it was just so random. And he was going like, I don't get this Nth Man. What's going on? Like, it's not Nth Man. Oh, Jesus. Nth Man.
I don't know what you're talking about.
It was really obscure, but I desperately... there will be a pocket of people out there going, oh my God, yes! Yeah. It was really
good.
This is
our guy.
I don't know how you get hold of it now. It's not been collected at all, I don't think. And it might be one of those... I don't think they couldn't even collect it. They couldn't even have another company collect it, because there are heavy Marvel references throughout. Because his brother or whatever he is in it is such a big Marvel fan.
Got it.
So it's Marvel are the only ones that can reprint it. I mean, to be honest, if they did it as a trade paperback, I'd take it. But I mean, I'd love it. If they released that as an omnibus, I was thinking, like, what would I like that's left field that came out? And I would get super excited if they announced it. Because if I know I keep saying this, but if they'll do Knights of Pendragon, they'll literally do anything at this point.
Yeah, that's the thing, right?
Yeah.
They're pretty much making you feel like we'll print anything.
Yeah.
But and then
there's one thing I would like to see that's super random. If they released that, I would be weirdly excited. And yes, it would happen. I'd get it.
Okay. All right. I like
that's
it.
That's my five, man. What's your last?
I'm trying to think beyond myself right now.
Wow. That sounds weird. Existential.
I did.
Are you Adam Warlock?
Yes. I love it.
I knew it.
I'm going to say you would know way better than me if it would be worthy to be completed. But I feel like Secret Avengers, that starts with Brubaker and ends with Remender,
mm-hmm.
would be, I think it's 36 issues.
I can't remember if it was all that set. Long. Was it that long? It might have been.
I think so. Because this is what I was drawing a blank for a little bit when I was trying to come up with a list of different ones that I didn't mention last time.
Mm-hmm.
And I came up with some ones that I'm like, yeah, you know what? That'd be a good pick.
Yeah,
but I saw Secret Avengers was like, that should be cover to cover. Now, I don't know if it would be a incomplete sort of story. I don't know how it ends, but Remender, Brubaker, Ennis.
Yeah, three big names as writers on that series. And some really good artists as well. I have to remind myself who they are.
I think Diodato is on it.
John Cassidy does the interiors for the Ennis run.
I'm not sure. I think it's Patrick Zurcher is an artist on it. I think. I could be misquoting, but yeah, I think
Michael Lark.
Yeah, there you go.
I am. Yeah, there are a couple of bits that do that are crossovers, so like Secret Fear Itself, it ties into, but I think it's still fairly standalone. And there's an Avengers versus X-Men trio of issues. But for the most part, yeah, I mean, the thing is, there was a follow-up series as well. Was it two follow-up series? Can't remember, but it turned into more like a spy book.
Yeah,
so it was like a secret part of S.H.I.E.L.D. It was Hawkeye, Mockingbird, Black Widow, Nick Fury Jr. And I think there was someone else in there, but I honestly can't remember. But that I remember reading that as well. I stuck with it during that, and it was still good stuff. I think it was, I don't know how you pronounce his name, is it Arles Cott?
And Michael Walsh, yeah. Michael Walsh is a local guy.
Oh, really?
Yeah. No, you're right. That is, it was a good series. It was very, like, I wouldn't say off the beaten path, not at all, but it was one of those books where you'd have to be reading everything to get your attention, and it was worthwhile. It was a good series, but it wasn't...
Yeah, it was good.
It wasn't blockbuster enough. But I feel that the name recognition on the original Secret Avengers during a pretty prolific era of Avengers, like, those are some good writers to have in one cover to cover sort of series. Good artists, good writers. Why hasn't it been made yet?
That's an interesting shout. It's the kind of thing I think, like, they could consider. I know, you know, with all the series and stuff they're doing and the films they're doing, they could consider that concept.
I think they will, actually. I think that this, we can expect this at some point in time, because if I'm not mistaken, Shang-Chi is on this team as well.
Yes. So yeah, the era you're talking about, I think initially it's like, it's a weird lineup because it's Moon Knight, Valkyrie initially. It's Steve Rogers, not Captain America anymore.
That's right. Yeah.
Black Widow. Memory's bad now. I can't quite remember. Well, he comes in later. But yeah, eventually he does come in.
This definitely has a market.
It's like Black Ops, Avengers Mission. The initial series, volume, oh, Nova's on it as well, briefly. Yeah, the first series is still Black Ops, but it's a little bit more kind of explosive and out there and kind of, it's like a Black Ops blockbuster. But the second and third series are kind of Black Ops, more low key.
Right, okay.
But yeah, the Remender stuff is bizarre, but I want to read it again because it's odd.
Already, I have it on my shelf. I have, there's two volumes. There's the...
Oh, that's right.
They had the one that was Brubaker, and then they had the Remender. And then the stuff in the middle has never been, it's just like orphaned.
Oh.
Like they've never put it in a series to match these ones. So it's like, let's put it all 36 issues. Just do it.
Good choice. It's a really good choice.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's a really good call.
Wow,
nice. That's a good way. Good way to finish up the episode, actually, dude. Instead of with, it's lucky it wasn't me. People going, what the zenth, man?
Do you have any honorable mentions, or do you want to save them for another time in case?
We could save them.
Okay.
To be honest, the list I've got, we could probably do two more of these this year. So, like, I'm happy to sit on them for now. I think if there's one thing I would like to see reprinted, it would be the Loki Journey into Mystery. I'm not a big Kieran Gillen person, as I've also said many times, but the Loki Journey into Mystery collected edition, I do want to see reprinted. I can't think of another that I really desperately want.
Didn't think of enough of something to reprint, and I think I had one in my head while I was like, oh, they should reprint that though, but now it's escaped me.
Edit it in afterwards when you do that. And not sure want me to react. Yeah. Yeah, that's a really good choice, man. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, they should really do that book.
I think they should continue the Avengers era of Bendis. Like, it's just incomplete for no reason.
For that, the most popular eras, it's weird that they haven't. I mean, the thing is, they did that volume one. They could reprint it with a nicer spine. And then volume two could easily... I mean, the thing, yeah, they could do all of that, and they could still do the Dark Reign thing.
Mm.
They've done Secret... Whoa, you got one.
And I know my reprint, Captain America by Mark Waid.
Yes. Good call.
Want that reprinted.
Very good call.
I would sacrifice something on my shelf to make room for that. I don't know what, but I would.
It's one of those ones that I look back and I don't know why. I think there were just too many that month or something.
But you want to know what? It wasn't printed well.
Yeah, I remember you saying, actually.
Yeah, there's been some issues with the spine on that one. So it's due for a reprint. Like, it's out there. People love the series. It was good enough for you to print it in an omnibus once. Put it back out there and do it a better job this time.
Yeah.
Right? Sometimes you have a bad batch. Okay. We'll save some for another episode.
Let's do it. And I can put you through the hell of trying to think. I can send you my list and shit. Dude, I've got a massive list here.
I got like 7, 8 more, maybe 10 more.
Should we do one later in the year?
Sure. Why not? We'll see if anything gets announced and we'll be like, see, you're all welcome. We did it. Awesome.
I'm not saying it again. Hey,
as always, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Great way. Middle of the week. Hump day.
Breaks it up.
Yes.
Nicely. Awesome. Cheers, dude.
Thank you, everybody, for listening. As you follow all of the social media things that we recommended to you, if you want to keep up with us, but also rate and review the show. Subscribe. It really, really makes a difference. So if you're listening to this now and you're like, nah, maybe. No, just please, just press subscribe and just give a 5-star review because it helps. It really does.
Yeah,
I know maybe. it sounds shameless, but help out if you like the show. We're trying. Thank you, everybody. Shout out to Misha again, show producer. Can't do it without you. We will be back soon. Dave, I bid you adieu.
Adieu. Good night.
Good night.